Hi everybody! Today I'm going to be talking about carbon isotopes, specifically stable carbon isotopes, and how we can use them as paleoenvironmental and paleoclimate indicators. So first, just to start with the absolute basics, I talked about isotope basics in the first stable isotope video, the oxygen isotope one. So if you've seen that, you can skip through the next few minutes, but basically isotopes have the same number of protons but different number of neutrons. And for this reason, we write isotopes in a special notation in which we show at the top left corner of each elemental letter the number of both protons and neutrons added together. For example, in carbon, 6 protons and 6 neutrons makes 12. Therefore, we have a carbon 12. However, there's another carbon isotope that has 7 neutrons, but it still has 6 protons because the proton number is what defines an element. So therefore, it's carbon 13 because 6 plus 7 is 13. Now that we have the gist of the notation, you can see here that in this table, the natural abundance of carbon 12 and 13 is shown, and carbon 12 makes up the majority of natural carbon on Earth, and carbon 13 is much less abundant, but we can still detect it and therefore take a ratio of carbon 13 to 12. And with this ratio, we can understand certain environmental conditions because the ratio is dependent on climatic and environmental factors. Now, like I said in my oxygen isotope video, we always take the heavy over the light isotope ratio, never light over heavy. So remember that whenever we're talking about the carbon isotope ratio, it's the ratio of 13 to 12. Now, we talked about carbon 12 and carbon 13 with the extra neutron in the last slide, but carbon also has another isotope, carbon 14. Carbon 14, however, is radioactive and has 2 extra neutrons, so it has 8 neutrons in total and is unstable. Therefore, it undergoes radioactive decay. For that reason, we cannot use it in stable isotope ratios because its concentration isn't constant. It decays into nitrogen 14. And so we can use it for dating. And if you want to know more about that, you can watch the absolute dating video. But we can't use it in the same way that we can use the 13 to 12 ratio that we're going to talk about in this video. So how does the carbon 13 to 12 ratio fluctuate throughout the environmental systems on Earth? Well, in this figure, we can see the carbon isotope ratios are greatly affected by biological processes such as photosynthesis. We know that carbon dioxide is taken up by plants and other photosynthesizing organisms, and that these plants build their structures with the carbon from the carbon dioxide. However, when they take up carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, they take up more carbon dioxide that has the lighter isotope, carbon 12, and less of it that has the carbon 13 ratio. This discrimination causes a heavier carbon isotope signature in the atmosphere and oceans during times of increased biological productivity and a lighter isotopic signature in the atmosphere and oceans during times of little biological activity, such as before organisms evolved.
And these organisms can and do eventually die, and this dead organic carbon material can then be incorporated into sediment that can then, over millions of years, be incorporated into a rock record. And we can measure in this preserved carbon the isotopic ratios and understand not only the biological productivity during the time those rocks formed, but also the types of plants that that organic carbon came from. And the reason we can understand the type of plants and photosynthetic organisms that produce that organic carbon is because photosynthesis is not a universal process in terms of the discrimination of carbon 12 over 13, meaning that certain photosynthetic processes, such as those seen in C3 versus C4 plants, show different carbon isotope ratios because C3 plants discriminate more heavily against carbon 13, meaning they take up a lighter ratio of carbon isotopes than C4 plants do. Both of them discriminate against C13, but C4 does not discriminate as heavily. This classification, C3 versus C4 plants, is just one of the ways that we can understand what type of plants were around making that carbon. There are many other categories that we can divide photosynthetic organisms into. For example, there's not only plants, there's also bacteria that photosynthesize, and we'll talk about this a little bit later. But first, what can we use to get these carbon isotope ratios from ancient environments? Where can we find these carbon isotopes other than just modern plants and the modern atmosphere? Well, we can look to the past in fossils. Not only can we look in the past by looking at tree rings and measuring carbon isotopes from those rings, but also we can use actual fossils of plants from much older periods. And we not only can use the carbon isotope ratios from fossil plants if there's enough carbon material, but we can also use morphology of plant fossils, meaning shapes and structures of things like leaf fossils shown here, because we know in modern systems, trees with smooth leaves like to live in certain environments, and trees with spiky leaves like to live in certain environments, and trees with needle-like leaves like to live in certain environments, and trees with thick leaves like to live in certain environments. And when these things get preserved in the rock record, we can make similar analogies for the past. But these are always used in conjunction with things like isotopic ratios or other geochemical proxies. In addition to just plant fossils and tree rings, we can also find organic carbon material in fossil fuels. Because like I said, dead plant material can accumulate and form sedimentary deposits of organic rich material that we call fossil fuels. In these organic rich sediments, we can tell that they came from plants because of the discrimination of carbon 12 over 13 isotopes, meaning these fossil fuel deposits have very light isotopic signatures. And because of this, when we burn these fossil fuels, we are releasing really light, or carbon 12 rich, carbon isotopes into the atmosphere, because those were all stored for so many years due to the photosynthetic processes that occurred in the past to make those fossil fuel deposits. And in addition to releasing all this really light carbon from these fossil fuel deposits, we are also releasing really low carbon 14 ratios. And this is because, like I said, carbon 14 is radioactive, so it decays, meaning that plant material that died millions of years ago, which is what these fossil fuels are, is going to have a really low carbon 14 ratio to nitrogen 14, its decay product. And therefore, we are leaving a signature in the atmosphere of carbon isotopes, not only a signature carbon 14 ratio, but also a signature carbon 13 to 12 ratio. And with this signature, we can tell exactly how much CO2 in the atmosphere is caused by us burning fossil fuels versus natural processes. And to anticipate your next question, we've looked into it, and yes, the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere and the global warming that is caused by it is our fault. The majority of carbon dioxide accumulating in the atmosphere today has the exact signature of the burning of fossil fuels. There is no other process that could be causing global warming. But on a more joyful topic, let's move on to what other sources of carbon isotopes might get preserved in the rock record. Other than organic carbon, where else could we measure carbon isotopes? How about the air? The other half of the photosynthetic system is the atmosphere. That's where the carbon dioxide that the plants are getting their carbon from is coming from. So when they're pulling out all that carbon 12, they're leaving behind a pretty heavy carbon isotope signature in the atmosphere. But how can we know or measure the carbon isotope ratio of ancient air? Ancient air isn't getting preserved. Well, yes it is. And this is the awesome thing about air bubbles. So we all know that ice cores can be used to measure certain oxygen and hydrogen isotopic ratios in the frozen water molecules from the layers of the ice cores. However, not only do the ice cores include frozen water, but they also include air bubbles. When the snow is forming into ice, it traps air bubbles during the time that it was forming the ice. Therefore, we can measure carbon isotopes and carbon dioxide concentrations in the air or the ancient atmosphere from these ice cores. But that is not the only place that we can find ancient atmosphere preserved. Additionally, there are air bubbles in amber. Amber does an amazing job at preserving fossilized insects or feathers, like I've talked about in the fossil preservation video. But air bubbles in amber could be just as important. Because amber can go back a super long time in Earth's history, we can use these air bubbles in ancient amber to understand a lot about the ancient atmosphere and how it evolved. But other than organic carbon and the atmosphere, where else can we measure carbon isotopes? Well, I'm glad you asked. Calcium carbonate. We talked about this in the oxygen isotope video because calcium carbonate not only has carbon, but also oxygen. But if you haven't watched that, I'm going to go back through it. Basically, calcium carbonate is incorporated into a lot of aquatic organism skeletons, and this allows us to take the carbon and oxygen isotope signatures from the hard parts of these organisms, which we can do for not only modern organisms that have calcium carbonate skeletons, but also ancient organisms. Because if you watch the fossil preservation video, you know that hard parts like calcium carbonate skeletons get preserved. This is fortunate for us because organisms like foraminifera, which are microscopic animals with these calcium carbonate tests or skeletons, build their tests with the oxygen and carbon from the water that they live in, meaning that they indiscriminately take up oxygen from the water molecules surrounding them and carbon from the carbon dioxide that gets absorbed by the ocean from the atmosphere, and they put it into their skeletons, preserving the isotope ratios that were originally in the water and atmosphere. So when we measure these ratios, we can make direct assumptions about the temperature of the water that that organism formed in using oxygen isotope ratios, and about the carbon dioxide content of the atmosphere and biological productivity during the time that that forum formed from the carbon isotope ratios. Additionally, we can use carbon isotope ratios from other carbonate fossils, such as mollusks or corals, which also form their skeletons with calcium carbonate. This is important because unlike forams and corals, mollusks can be either marine or freshwater, meaning that we can not only gain a marine proxy from looking at mollusk fossils, but we can also gain a freshwater proxy and a terrestrial atmospheric proxy. For understanding the oxygen isotope composition of continental freshwater and precipitation values, and we can understand the biological productivity on continents rather than only in the ocean. Also, if you want to see more about paleoclimate proxies using mollusk fossils and other calcareous organism fossils, you can look at the oxygen isotope video, the sulfur isotope video, or the strontium isotope video. And we can get even more specific when we look at seasonal variations within the shells and skeletons of these organisms. Analogous to tree rings, mollusks and other organisms that build their shells with calcium carbonate build them faster in some seasons and slower in others. And with this, the formation of layers occurs. And these are growth layers. And we can distinguish annual layers and seasonal layers from most mollusk shells and then understand how drastic the seasonal variations and climate were during the time that that mollusk was forming. And we understand this using isotopes. Additionally, another organism that builds its structure, in this case a microbial mat, with calcium carbonate are cyanobacteria. They form stromatolites. Stromatolite, pictured to the left here, is a microbial mat that can become fossilized because these cyanobacteria accumulate calcium carbonate within their mat. And when they do this, they form not only something that can be preserved because it is now hard sediment, but also something that has a distinct structure that they leave their signature on. Not only their physical signature, as you can see with these squiggly lines here, but also their chemical signature, meaning the isotopic ratios. Cyanobacteria are photosynthetic organisms, meaning these bacteria, like plants, photosynthesize. They actually take up carbon dioxide from the atmosphere and they release oxygen. They were actually the first photosynthesizers to really change the atmospheric composition of our planet. Before these guys came along, there was hardly any oxygen in the atmosphere of Earth. And once they came along, they started accumulating in huge amounts and causing the oxygen in the atmosphere to increase for the first time in Earth's history. And if they had never come along, we would not be here. But regardless, they also, just like plants, discriminate between carbon isotopes when they photosynthesize. When they take up carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, they take up more carbon-12 than they do 13. And they do this in a distinctive way from C3 and C4 plants, and therefore we can measure carbon isotopes from not only the carbonate material and stromatolites themselves, but also in other carbon-rich rocks that may preserve the atmospheric carbon signature left over from the cyanobacteria's activity. And what I mean by this is things like graphite. Graphite is made up of pure carbon, so its carbon isotopes might reflect the system that biological processes are affecting when they're discriminating between isotopes. For example, there's a graphite formation from the Archean about 3.7 billion years ago, and this is called the Isua supercrustal belt in western Greenland, and it has such distinctive carbon isotopic ratios that it's been interpreted to be evidence for early life on Earth. And so while this is an indirect fossil, it is still a fossil in that it is a biochemical signature left behind from other organisms that affected the carbon isotopes that went into the formation of this graphite. For more on biochemical signatures and modes of fossil preservation, see my fossil preservation video. Another paleoclimate proxy using carbon isotope ratios could be used from carbonate nodules. Carbonate nodules are actually carbonate material that is not biologically formed, but rather formed by the process in which rainwater or groundwater that infiltrates soils that is rich in soluble minerals such as calcium carbonate might be evaporated or transported, and in the process leave behind nodules of the minerals that have precipitated out, such as calcium carbonate minerals, and these nodules are preserved in paleosols, or ancient fossilized soils, and we can measure the carbon and the oxygen isotope ratios within these nodules to understand more about the rain or groundwater that went into their formation, as well as about the atmosphere carbon dioxide signature, because that is what goes in to making the carbonate ions that the water holds. And lastly, I'm going to discuss one more carbon isotope paleoclimate proxy, and this is in the use of palynology, which is the study of pollen and microscopic algae. And I talked about coccolithophores a little bit in the oxygen isotope episode. But basically, these are single cellular organisms that are microscopic algae that have these shields surrounding their cell that are made of carbonate material. And for this reason, they can become preserved in the rock record. Additionally, fossilized pollen can be really useful because pollen forms really specific morphologies or shapes and structures that we can identify and understand something about the plants that were living there. And we can take carbon isotope ratios as well to understand even more specifically about the ecological and environmental conditions during the time that that pollen was deposited. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you learned about the things that we can learn from carbon isotope paleoclimate proxies. And I hope you continue on to watch the oxygen isotope, hydrogen isotope, strontium isotope, sulfur isotope, and molybdenum isotope episodes, also about stable isotope proxies. These proxies are incredibly important for our understanding of Earth's history and Earth's modern processes. So please go check those out as well. And I'll see you guys next time. Bye.